The following program is a special presentation from News Center 4.
I'm Sylvia Chase. For the next hour, you're going to see through the eyes of 16 of the finest photographers in America. Together, they've won hundreds of awards for the way they cover wars and fires and sports and politics. But for one day, Friday, August 22nd, their assignment was different. Their theater of operations was the San Francisco Bay Area, and they flew over it, they dove under it. They shot through brilliant sunshine and through midnight fog. For those 24 hours, their job was to capture something both elusive and absolutely real, the wonder of everyday life.
It Happened One Day is brought to you by Kaiser Permanente. As a member of Kaiser Permanente, you'll have more than a healthcare plan. And by Hyundai, we make cars that make sense. And by Bank AmeriCard, Visa, and MasterCard. No other cards offer you so much. And now, It Happened One Day.
A crop duster heads into the wind to begin the morning's work. His territory is Rio Vista, a place caught between the winds of the land and the winds of the sea. This is small town America.
It turns big. The wind's from the southwest about 9 miles an hour.
Here in the Delta Country, it's the wind and the sun that rule the day. Here, water is a road. This Friday morning, there's no rush hour.
We see somebody we recognize, sometimes we just stop, come right back and pick them up.
If there were more people and more cars, the Ryer Island Ferry might be a bridge, but the boat will do. This is a part of America where a summer day feels like a summer day. The river here takes its time about connecting with the bay and the sea. And the people here take their time, too. Time to take it all in. Everybody's in a rush at Anne's Cafe. Here, the laughter that Francis inspires is food for the soul.
Oh, my linguica! Oh, Mamma Mia! Where do you want me to stick these onions? Lady, have a bag of onions. How about Sergeant Sam? You told me you were Sergeant last week.
Right. Every cop in the city knows this place. Every cop.
Why?
Because it's great food. Great people. Francis is the greatest. And if you don't say that, she'll poison your food.
Oh, no, look at all. Oh, in my next life, I'm going to be homely and lonely. It's hell to be beautiful, I'll tell you. You're Italian! Mamma mia! Another kiss. Oh, Mamma mia.
Mm. I'm down on the ground, I'm making sure that my partner does not hurt anybody that's down there. You know, I'm his lookout man down below.
To me, this is, it's exciting. You know, I like what I'm doing. I like working with different peoples.
When I leave home, it's like a metamorphosis, you know. I change from that person at home into a crane operator. And when I get here, it's all serious.
I can't lock on this container. I'll try it again.
The most important thing is the people that work around me, you know. Their lives are more important than the containers, than how many I can do an hour. I'm 38 years old, been on the waterfront 20 years. It's still fun. Maybe a few years from now it won't be fun, and maybe I'll stop doing it.
You're 16 yet?
It's like a John Henry syndrome, you know, trying to beat the rail driving machine. And maybe you beat it, but in the end you die.
Come on, guys, shine them up here. Put a glow on that toy. You ready yet? Come here.
Are you ready? I got that color for you, Chief. Shine them up right here. Uh-oh, fellas, come here. You ready right here?
I'm gonna do this one up nice, though.
I'm an independent businessman. I started with nothing, and I'm gonna have some. And if I work at it more and more each day, God will bless me. The devil can't bless me. The devil, he ain't nothing but a loser, okay? God, he loves me, and that's why he got me out here shining shoes.
Much of a good thing is simply wonderful. When it comes to money, everybody's got that idea, most everybody, don't you think so? Yeah, it's real crazy. It's the craziest darn thing. So what's all the rush about?
Universes coexist this Friday morning, parallel worlds with their own laws and logic, but unaware of each other. Worlds where fortunes turn on the wave of a hand. A floating city visiting the nation that it defends. And this multi-million-dollar world behind guarded gates, where brown foothills have been carved and watered into green estates. Here, new money buys old values.
Hi, how you doing?
Barbara Nagel sells real estate here. Last year, $13.5 million worth.
Blackhawk to me is where I live. It's where I work. This was where we could find a quality of life, a place where I wanted to raise my children. Probably the most magnificent setting you could ever find anywhere.
Her husband's promotion has taken him on to Minneapolis. Their kids and Barbara's ambition keep her here. It's a two-city marriage now, and it's working.
You never lose sight, though, of where your marriage is. We've been married a long enough time to realize that each one of us has the right to be the person they are, and probably the healthiest thing is to allow the other individual to be what they want to be.
Yeah, nice to be home.
These priests have chanted for 40 days and will chant for another 28 before their temple is dedicated to the dozen gods enshrined here. A cowgirl like Katie Ladd's a creature of our times as she rides the family's 5,000 acres. But at her father's forge, metal meets fire just as it always has. Janice Johnson uses music to create a world of elegance for the shoppers.
What color is that? I'm using a color called Blazing Ruby.
Some of the music is her own, but this is her secret.
I like the lips. I don't usually go that dark.
But it's the lips look very pretty on you. Very, very pretty.
In this classroom sits a Nobel laureate who once worked on the atom bomb project. Now, Owen Chamberlain is wondering about the world he'll leave behind.
I have a granddaughter born just a month ago, and I hope we'll leave her a peaceful world, one in which nuclear war is not a threat.
And beneath the gray sea of the North Coast, another secret world goes about its business. The same rituals of hunger and life and death that have been played here for a million Friday mornings.
Nice to be sexy once in a while, you know, and carry on a fantasy, you know.
Libby Osborne spends most of her working day taking off her clothes. She's a stripper at the Mitchell Brothers. She's 21 years old, and she is a lesbian.
I like women.
Why?
Because they're sexy, and they're soft. And that's why I was born. Can't change it. God knows I've tried.
Julia's been Libby's lover for 4 months now. She's a bodybuilder, and she's always known that she's a lesbian.
That's the way I know it, you know. I'm very comfortable. It makes me happy, you know. I don't know anything different, to tell you really the truth.
A friend introduced them at a club. Julia says it was lust and love at first sight.
Not so glad.
Yes. And she's a beautiful woman. Just, I've seen her a few times around, and I thought she's very attractive, and I go for those type of women.
She liked me, and I liked her. What was the attraction? Haven't you seen her?
But two different approaches to life and a 10-year age gap have led to a parting.
Time being, it's best that I moved out and she's living with me, and now she's moved somewhere and I moved somewhere. We'll still see each other, but it's, we went too fast. Maybe we gotta slow it down and be more open and more real about it.
My life hasn't been normal, I guess. I left home when I was young, and I've just lived a hard life. My teen years were hard, and I was in this business, and this business can make you grow up fast, especially for somebody very young, and who shouldn't be working when she's a minor, and she should be in junior high, you know. She shouldn't be on stage stripping.
Is she ever attracted to men?
Not too much. There are some men that I see that are good-looking. Most of them are gay, though. We have pretty gay men in the city, that's for sure. But that's it. I look at them, and they're nice-looking. And I've been with men, but I don't think they'd be a good one-night stand, maybe, every 2 years.
For these women, The only journey beyond the walls of their monastery is the journey to a parent's deathbed. Here, today is like yesterday and like tomorrow. This Friday is like the 700 other Fridays since Sister Mary of the Holy Family took her vow of silence.
I think I love people so much and I enjoy life so much that I wanted to give my life to God in a special way. If we go out into the world and spend most of our time in the world, we're not fulfilling our objective, and that is prayer and penance. And I really believe that prayer can reach out and touch the lives of those outside who are suffering and in need. We have 11 acres, so there's ample opportunity to walk and to meditate and to be alone. So many people have such a low esteem about themselves, and to realize that God loves them just the way they are, without any changes, just the way they are.
This story was supposed to begin at an airport. Photographer Craig Franklin's assignment was to meet a plane with a group of tourists from Japan. He wanted to see their wonder during their single day in San Francisco, but Craig's well-laid plans got sidetracked, derailed.
They were supposed to come into San Francisco Airport, that's what I had thought, from Los Angeles. And they actually came in by Amtrak train from Seattle. So we were kind of looking south and they snuck in behind us from the north. And they ended up at the Oakland Amtrak station without any tour guide or bus driver or anything. I mean, we showed up and they wondered where their tour was. Of course, I'm dreaming of the shot of the plane coming in and them getting off and being greeted by their tour guide. And what happened at Amtrak was when their tour guide finally got there, he didn't want to have anything to do with television. I don't know if it's because he was embarrassed or what. And instead, he sort of just hid in a corner and sort of waved at them. Didn't really want to be on camera. And when I asked him if he was going to greet the group, he said, "No, no, we just get on the bus and go." So that's what they did. Well, it was tougher than I thought. I was with my wife, Yuko, who's Japanese. And I thought that would help sort of break the ice and that we'd really get into the heart and soul of a Japanese tourist. I mean, the people come over here and they get on a tour bus and they go from bridge to park to statue and taking pictures the whole way. And it's a real busy day for them. And it was so hard to really tell the story that I wanted to tell that the whole day, I guess what I was thinking of, everybody else is around the Bay Area shooting beautiful pictures, and I'm here on Fisherman's Wharf trying to keep up with this Japanese tour group. And I wasn't sure if I was in the right place or not.
Three men had their dreams challenged this Friday. The skipper of baseball's comeback team. This young stand-up comedian.
This is not a burden for you.
And this man, Robert Maynard, the publisher of the Oakland Tribune. His job is the paper's day-to-day survival, and there's no guarantee he'll succeed. It's a big change from his earlier days at the Washington Post, where he quickly rose to the top.
And I said, I'm too young for all this. I really did. I felt, you're right, I had reached the pinnacle, but I couldn't see myself sitting for the next, what, say 20 years doing what I was doing there. I needed more of a challenge.
Maynard's confidence, his hands-on, face-to-face approach, these he copied from a Brooklyn businessman he admired, his father.
He had the same eyeball-to-eyeball contact. He didn't look down at anybody, and in a sense, he didn't feel he had to look up to anybody. He was himself. And when I go through this building, I like to think that every person I meet in the halls or in one of the offices is a colleague. I don't put a
label on them that says, this is a 9 colleague, and this one over here in the press room is a 4 or such a thing.
Maynard is sure enough of his newspaper's survival now to begin dreaming about its future.
What I really want the paper to be is not so much a reflection of the people here as the people out there. I want the readers to feel that they see across these two counties a reflection of themselves, their lifestyle. Then they make that my paper, and that's what's really important.
You hit the way hits in the game.
I think it's very important that a manager stays as close as he possibly can. You know, when you've got 25 players and 5 coaches and you stay together for 8 months, it's a long time, and I got to have a lot of fun, and I think this club's had fun this year.
Last year wasn't much fun. The Giants lost 100 games. This Friday, they're in second place with fantasies about a pennant. Manager Roger Craig is a stubborn optimist.
I actually think it's good because I've been with coaches and managers that were very negative. And these things can rub off on your players. And when my players know that I'm very positive, when I think and say things and then they actually happen, then they're starting to, I think they still think I'm a little crazy at times, but they're starting to believe in a lot of things that I believe in.
We got a hum baby tonight.
It is a hum baby. The Giants are playing the Mets, who tower over the National League. That's why Roger Craig will be here at Candlestick Park tonight, and not at his daughter's second wedding.
Look how fat she is. We've kind of tried to put her on a diet, but she didn't really go for it. We try and just, she loves that dry food every day.
Yeah.
She eats that. That's all we give her, and she begs for it. It'd be like if you had to eat cardboard every day and you loved it.
For comedian Jake Johansson, everyday life is the stuff that laughs are made of.
What were those screams coming from the back room there? I don't know what, it's like some kind of human sacrifice. Hello? There's a kind of a, they're waiting for the court thing to clear up. They can't really say hello today. Let's go right in here. Well, I thought that it wasn't going to work a couple times, but I never, then I would always think, well, what if I stopped doing comedy, then where would I, then what would be my next thing that I would try and do? And it always turned out to be like welding or one of those technical institutes that are on late in the afternoon TV. Wow, it's a violation of federal law to use this product in a manner inconsistent with its labeling.
Wow, so if you used it on a cat, you'd get arrested.
No, that's legal. If I was to give you a flea shampoo, Frank.
But will he be funny on stage tonight? We'll see. And now we see our gallery of images lighted by a sun shrouded in fog. Half of our one day is gone. Half of its hours, half of its secrets and its sights still lie ahead. Friday, August 22nd. In the news that day, a plane in trouble that landed without trouble at San Jose Airport. A new plan to get rid of San Francisco's abandoned cars. Drug king Felix Mitchell was murdered in prison. And they spotted Humphrey the humpback whale again, but well beyond the bay out by the Farallons. Most of us stayed safely out of the headlines that day, but our 16 photographers met others for whom that day would always be history.
State of California.
Personal history. A big day, like the day they got married.
Your husband's smiling out there.
Good.
Give him a kiss.
Or the first day of life.
He's going to be in kindergarten, right?
Or the first day of school. Yay! For 9-year-old Robbie, each day is a great challenge. The whooping cough vaccine injured his brain and left him far behind other kids his age. At first, the doctor said Robbie wouldn't even be able to walk, and his parents felt terrible.
Shock
in the beginning, and disbelief, and I think at first I didn't realize the extent and also the impact on our family of having a handicapped child for life.
But his parents built a school around him, helping other kids too. And Robbie not only can walk, but he's starting to read.
Finger, good.
And what he can do may vary widely from one day to the next. And that takes time and effort and good people who are interested in him and love him.
For 12-year-old skateboarder Bruce Russell, this is the last Friday afternoon before season play begins, the football season.
My knee worries me because that could put me out for the rest of my life. Broken arms and stuff don't worry me.
Go! The whole town's football crazy, just like Bruce's family. His brother's a high school star, and their mom has a good, involved attitude.
This year, it'll probably be different for me. I'm used to watching the big guys knock him down. This year, maybe he'll have a chance, knock some of them down for a change.
Keep going, keep going, keep going, keep going. Good, good.
A couple of kids that can stop him hit up, but not too many.
This is only the rehearsal for Carolina Gomez. Tomorrow is the big day. From tomorrow, she will be a woman. This is what it means for a Latina to turn 15, a quinceañera. How does this make her feel?
Excited, real excited, yeah.
Today, the father of a little girl. Tomorrow, the father of a woman. There are rewards.
Okay.
Right. Yeah.
For the whole family, this is a day of pride. Listen to Carolina's mother.
She says that she hopes that I can value, you know, my life and to know how to make the right choices as I grow older. And that, you know, that she's happy for me.
Como un tesoro que Dios me ha dado.
Treasure from God.
Good afternoon. I'm Major McQueenie. I'll be administering your oath to you this afternoon. When you say your oath.
Another rite of passage. Every life in this room is about to change.
And defend the Constitution of the United States.
For 6 weeks, these nurses have taught Bob Bain that some kind of life will be possible after the fire. Burned in an explosion. He hasn't walked since. But this morning, he's sitting up. And he's willing to try to do more.
I'm going to try standing. Now you're taller than both of us. Okay? We'll be right next to you when you stand up. And you might want to sit down right away, and that's okay. Okay, ready?
Yep.
Great. Good. Well, you're not as tall as I thought.
Told you I wasn't.
A little marching in place, maybe, so you don't get too... How's it feel?
Well, it feels all right. I mean, that's great. Yeah. That's all right. That's right.
I can see the walls instead of the ceiling.
You're doing very well.
Where do you want to go, Bob?
Yeah, no, anywhere. Market Street.
Just listen to the beat. Travel 738 miles per hour.
Live by a satellite, it's me. Wow.
There is no nationalism. No, there is no soul.
Now, we used to play on the street in Honolulu, and we like playing on the street. It's an experiment. We don't know how long we're going to last.
Hey, look at that good-looking guy out there. God. And I would have to do it, Donnie. Honest to God, I'm telling you, all the things I'm missing in life right now, because I'm sitting out here and I'll feel like it.
Get out of here.
Usually what you do during the day, you know, it's like, it is, you know, like I said, you wait and you, you know, you meet up with your friends and you get all together and you see how much money you got together and you go and get drunk. How many people do you really know in the city of San Francisco walk around with no hair? Not too many, huh?
You get to know people because you see them all the time and because it's so small. They're always, hi, how are you? You know, what's going on out on the water today?
It's a nice little town to live in, especially trying to bring a family up. It's pretty good.
A view from the sky. It has a perspective all its own.
It felt like just a normal day in San Francisco to me. You know, the fog was there. It was beautiful in the outlying areas. And I was also struck, once again, I am every time I go up, by just by the diversity of what you can do in a very small radius of the center of San Francisco. Magnificently peaceful and calm perspective of the Bay Area from the air. I felt lucky to be here. There's something so serene about the helicopter, even though it's a rather stressful environment in itself. It puts you in places that are very, very magical and very, very serene.
Black Point Bridge on the Petaluma River. John Ogden is the keeper of this kingdom.
Come on, Funky. Come on. Time to go to work. Good girl. Come on, Funky. Let's go get the bridge. She's been part of my life, and they call her the railroad dog. Hurry up. And everybody on the line has known her and gives her the whistle, and they love her.
Twice a day for the past 20 years, Ogden has turned the swing span bridge. He turns it for pears and lumber aboard the Northwestern Pacific train from Eureka. Destination, Fairfield, and the eastbound Salad Bowl Express.
It's been operating, well, like since 1911. I'd say a printer every day. If it's grease, like an automobile, this will last forever. That's it. It just will run and run and run. It's just a neat bridge.
Once upon a time, these tracks were always busy with passenger trains as well as freight trains. It took three shifts working round the clock just to run John Ogden's bridge.
And that's when we had like eight trains in 24 hours going by here. And this was around the clock, manned it around the clock by three shifts.
Ogden is a 55-year-old widower who's unlikely to remarry. After all, his home is only 30 feet from these tracks, and he's on call around the clock, fair weather or foul, with only an occasional day off. But he considers himself lucky indeed. John Ogden is a railroad man.
Well, I guess I'm always enthused about it. I mean, I just love it. I'm never tired of it, never bored. I just look forward to each day. And I'm drop dead tomorrow. I hope somebody takes it over that they'll love it as much as I do.
I'm getting it nice and warm, just how you like it, Venus.
You're a movie star. This is the big shampoo scene. I can get you a commercial from this.
Ouch! Venus, oh, you really got a good grip there on my arm. I know.
Washing the cat, going shopping, this is what Jake Johansson talks about when he does comedy. Tonight, he works a huge barn of a hall in San Jose in a make-or-break comedy semifinal.
I just go out and I talk and I try and be relaxed and have a good time and drink plenty of fluids.
Why plenty of fluids?
I don't know. They always tell you that when you go to the doctor, no matter what you have, drink plenty of fluids. So I make it a policy right in my life to drink a lot of fluids.
Here, pretend you're Brooke Shields, and this is the Blue Lagoon.
Friday afternoon rush hour, Marin County style. No host bar on the Larkspur Ferry, but the hors d'oeuvres and the jazz are free. The item on the plate is the star at Stars. Starring tonight, boneless quail stuffed with foie gras mousse. And at Evie's Drive-In, only the prices are 1986. The music and the menu are out of the past. So are the tips. But for the car hops, there is a timeless attraction.
The guys.
There's a routine to working in this neon time machine.
Hi, can I take your order? Joe, my feet hurt. Can I come in for a
cold.
Break?
Can I change
my ass
my
is
pants?
Freezing, Joe. Can I put my pants on?
Best country music for you 24 hours a day.
Working hard to make a living, bringing shelter from the rain. A father's son left to carry on blue denim in his veins. Oh, he's a working class man.
Now Workday Friday is turning into Friday night. In Rio Vista, Foster's Bighorn is where the gentry gather.
They always say, well, a small town is no place for anybody, but listen,
We've all made a good living here, and it's a great little town.
He can get it back together like it used to be. Give me just another try. Can you move on or die? Give me one more chance. Give me one more chance. Won't you give me just one more chance? Maybe we can make a little romance. No reason why you and me can't get it back together like it used to be. Give me just another try.
After I came back from Vietnam, I figured the war was over, and I had to fight another war out here on the street. Tomorrow's another day. I'll have to see what happens when tomorrow shows up.
One night in Michigan, one cold winter night, I saw a spacecraft coming slowly towards my way, and they stopped and hovered over me for a while. They apparently knew the very exact moment I was going to be there. Because of the experience I had with that spacecraft, it improved my ESP tremendously. And I haven't been the same since.
Being gay is a hell of a lot different now than it was 5 years ago. Everybody on the street just about has known somebody who's been a very close friend, or at least a friend that has died of AIDS at this point. It's become much more sedate. People are much more real with each other. They're living each day as it could be their last.
The world belongs now to the night people, the ones who work in the night and find their pleasure here. And like this women's cycle gang, the Cogent Warriors, the ones who seem to exist only here, at home in the night.
I don't feel an outcast. I'm not in this group because we're a group of outcasts. We're not. We're a group of positive people that are looking ahead to tomorrow all the time. And we are an extended family. When you choose this lifestyle, you're giving up nuclear families. So we're extended family. We're sisters, and we're sisters of the soul.
The corridors of power are empty now, except for Julio Vialta, the man who makes them gleam. And at Eli's, the Mile High Club is never higher than on a Friday night. Owner Troyce Key has standards to maintain.
It's like my motto is, if you can't play the blues, can't play at Eli's.
Lou Holtz, that guy that's a football coach, came up with a great line. He says, coaches and managers, we all sleep like babies. We wake up in the middle of the night crying, and I really like that line.
Tonight, he may have something to cry about. He listens to his coaches, but he makes his own decisions. From the dugout, Craig is trying to invent the excitement, make his own luck.
But I hate to sit around and keep waiting for us to score runs without hitting and running or bunting or squeezing, and you keep waiting and waiting and get beat 2-1 or 1-0, something like that. That's why I like to create a lot of activity on the bases, because it forces a lot of mistakes, and we've been very successful at it. But I think it's up to what your personnel, what you have, the type of ball club that you do have. I like to have a club with a lot of speed, because I am an aggressive manager. I like to run a lot.
But tonight, Craig's men are running into trouble. It's the Giants making the mistakes, not the Mets.
Good thing anxiety is a part of your.
I'm harnessing it. I'm gonna harness the private hell that I'm in right now.
Jake got totally lost on his way here. He's on stage next, and the judges will see a shaken man.
If I had a preference, I would like to have my mom and my dad and Diane and Venus to be judges tonight.
But one lesson Jake never forgets, that a stand-up comedian never outgrows his need for fluids. Plenty of fluids. Craig started as a Dodger pitcher back in 55. A lot of years. The tough old pro knows when a kind word counts.
I remember in St. Louis, Robbie Thompson made 3 errors in one game. and we got beat. So I closed the door of the clubhouse. And I said, hey, Robbie, right in front of the whole club. I said, you've won a lot of games for us this year. This does not bother me. It's not going to bother you because tomorrow you'll probably win the game for us. I said, forget about it, and we'll come out tomorrow and we'll win. I said, but I don't want you to worry about this.
I believe that they exist.
This is where Jake's day was aiming, 5 minutes alone in front of 2,000 strangers.
I like the slogan, the NRA. I love that slogan. It's not the guns that kill people. I like that because I think we all know it's those darn bullets. The guns make them go really fast, but... bullets do. It'd still be hard to imagine a guy robbing a liquor store or something with just a handful of bullets, you know? Put all the money into the bag and hurry it up. Or I push these into your brain one at a time.
He's a hit. Second place money for Jake tonight. As for the Giants, they're losing. It's the bottom of the ninth, and Will Clark singles in a run, making it 5-3. Optimism in the dugout, optimism in the stands. But Chris Brown flies out to end the game. Tonight, the Giants are losers.
Hey guys, see you later.
For Roger Craig, it's already yesterday's game. And his day ends with a call to his wife.
Okay, goodbye. I love you. All right, bye-bye.
Friday, August 22nd, is in the record book, not only for the Giants, but for all of us.
It's going to be Bobby Ojeda against Kelly Downs, and it's also Pacific Belt Family Softball Day. And thanks a lot for attending tonight's ball game, and please drive carefully.
It happened one day, has been brought to you by Hyundai. We make cars that make sense. And by Kaiser Permanente. As a member of Kaiser Permanente, you'll have more than a health care plan. And by Air Canada.
The day was Friday, August 22nd, 1986. We were all there, but we didn't all see the same things. It's a special gift, letting other people see the world the way you do. Here now, the faces and the voices of the photographers whose vision we've shared for this hour. I'm Sylvia Chase.
It was a special day. It really was. I've never done anything like this, and it was fun. It was a challenge.
I was impressed by the city and how there's so much diversity in a city compacted in such a small area.
What gives you a sense of the Bay Area is participating in people's lives, and that's what we did yesterday.
And I found that generally the people we dealt with here were no different than the people I deal with in the Midwest. Just good folks.
If you could go someplace within an hour and a half drive of San Francisco, it's the way America was.
You have a chance for a project like this to just stop and look and listen and feel things.
To a cameraman who deals with visuals, there's some real special things I think other people don't see.
There's always something interesting, even in the most mundane places.
There's so much life and energy and electricity on Market Street. People draw their life.
I think our day was probably about 21 hours from when we started in the morning till when we got home at the end of the evening.
I had an opportunity to meet with and talk with some of the very, very finest photographers in the country.
Just a lot of driving, that day. Down to Gilroy, back to San Jose, down to Gilroy.
Their existence is to pray. That's what they do.
Underwater has always fascinated me with the colors, and it's another world down there. It truly is.
Well, I guess all news cameramen are adrenaline junkies to one sense or another. And this is just another form of adrenaline pumping, I suppose.